We'll wait, inshallah ta'ala, for a few minutes for people to join. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. It has been a while since we met, but last time we had the session, it was about the permissible things or الأمور المباحة أو المباح فعلها في الصلاة, the thing, permissible things in salah. And today, inshallah ta'ala, we will talk about al-makruhat fi salah, ma yukrahu fi'luhu fi salah, what is disliked to be done in salah. And when we say makruh, as a rule, of course, we know that makruh is one of the ahkam al-khamsa, the five rules. Al-makruh huwa alladhi la yu'aqab fa'ilu, وَيُثَابُ تَارِكُ, the one who, if you do not do it, you get rewarded for it, and if you do it, there is no punishment, which means that whatever the makruhat that we will talk about in the salah, they are not going to invalidate the salah. And salah صحيحة, even though these makruhat, disliked things, are done in the salah. So the arkan of the salah are kept intact, the shurut, sahat al-salah, are kept intact. So the makruhat are things that are additional that the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam discouraged us from doing. And therefore, we should do them taqarruban, yani we should not do them, we should abstain from them, taqarruban, getting close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so the first, and of course, just as a reminder, we are using Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq's book, Fiqh al-Sunnah, rahimahullah, as a guide in our discussion. And what I will do is to always discuss other things, some madhahib, their points of view, just to add more or to enrich the discussion, inshallah ta'ala, a bit more. So the first thing that is disliked is al-abath bil-thawb. You know, the first thing that is disliked is to fiddle, to play with something or with part of your body or something that would keep you distracted from a salah. And the where did they come up with this? It's based on the hadith of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam from that's reported by Mu'ayqib. He said, سألت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن مسح الحصى في الصلاة. مسح الحصى في الصلاة. I will explain it now. فقال لا تمسح الحصى وأنت تصلي. فإن كنت لابد فاعلا فواحدة. تسوية الحصى. And this hadith is reported by الجماعة. Okay. So the hadith is صحيح. And also Abu Dhar reported that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا قام أحدكم إلى الصلاة فإن الرحمة تواجهه فلا يمسح الحصى أخرجه أحمد وأصحاب السنن. Also أم سلمة reported that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لغلام له يقال له يسار وكان قد نفخ في الصلاة ترب وجهك لله. رواه أحمد بإسناد جيد. Okay, so there are three hadiths that are involved in the touching things or playing with things in the salah. The first is the hadith of Mu'ayqib, okay? And when he said, I asked the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I asked the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam about Masih al-Hasa. Masih al-Hasa, keep in mind, at the time of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the floor of the masjid was not carpeted, of course. It was hasa. It was gravel, So what is Masih al-Hasa is to actually fix it before you do the sujood, or while you're sitting there, you fix it so that when you go down for sajda, you find it even. And even though the gravel is mixed between the stones and the dirt, the turab, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used the word hasa because they're normally, you know, يعني ألحق الحصى بالتراب. Okay, and he said, فإن كنت فاعل كنت فإن كنت لابد فاعل, if you really have to and it's really bothering you that you know you are going to, then do it only once. So الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, in other words, allowed it, allowed us to do that if you really gonna do it once, but do not keep fixing it, you know. So it, you're allowed once. Other than that, it is makruh. Okay. Now, and this is the you know, as Ibn Rushd said, this is what most scholars have agreed on, that you, if you are going to do it, you are going to do it once. And in Imam al-Nawawi said that there is an agreement of the ulama that it is disliked to fix the hasa, the stones in the masjid, the gravel, when you are about, if you are praying in public. Like now, nowadays, the masajid are carpeted, okay? And so this subject itself becomes irrelevant, even though you can think of maybe removing lint from the carpet, fiddling with something like that. But because the ulama took that masḥ al-ḥaṣa and they extended it to what? To everything else that is like it. So to playing with your clothes, to, you know, fiddling with your watch, fixing your clothes. Sometimes a person comes out from the wudu and joins a salah, and in the while he is in salah, fixing his clothes, all of this. Unless there is really a need to do it, it becomes makruh for you to do it. Okay, so that's one. The hadith, you know, some now, of course, you have just as a the literalist school, which is Ibn Hazm, rahimahullah. His opinion, of course, it was haram, you know, if it is more than once. You know, because for him, he's Zahiri. So as a Zahiri school, every command is, or every nahi, every command not to do something, automatically, it is haram. And, you know, so even though he did not say the khushu', you know, to be concentrated in a salah is a must in a salah, he put this as some of the prohibitions of the salah. Now the other hadith. So now we know the first item is which is this, that we are not to, it's disliked, makruh, to play with things while in salah, whether your clothes or whether it is the stones, etc. Now you have another hadith that Imam that Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq mentions, which is the hadith of Abu Dharr, that the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if one of you gets up to pray, فَإِنَّ الرَّحْمَةَ تُوَاجِهُهُ, the mercy is facing him, فَلَا يَمْسَحِ الْحَصَى, then do not touch the stone, do not touch the pebbles. This hadith is ضعيف. This hadith is weak. And it's reported by Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, and Nisa'i, Ibn Majah, and the hadith is weak, so it is not valid to be utilized. So the command, the initial command, not to play with the stones, is the initial hadith from Mu'ayqib, and that is reported by the Jama'ah, by the seven, so there's no problem. But the other hadith that's reported by Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi and Nasa'i and Ibn Majah, that about Ar-Rahma tuwajihu, this hadith is daif. Okay, now the last hadith, which is the hadith of tarrib wajhak lillah, you know, the nafkh fi salah. You know, many people you hear them and they are praying and as if you know, and the hadith says tarrib wajhaka lillah, it means get closer to Allah Ta'ala, do not do these kinds of actions. And the hadith is a good it's a sound hadith reported by Imam Ahmad. Okay, but again, so nafakh fi salah is also from al-makruhat, from the things that are disliked to be done in as-salah. Now another item that is disliked in as-salah is at-takhassur. At-takhassur fi as-salah, it is when you put your hands on your side. And al-khasr you know, is the waist, which is right above the hip, you know, to so the khassur is on the side, because the batn, the belly is in the middle, and the khassur is on the side. Mm-hmm. So some people, you find them, they take their hands and they put it, you know, on the side. This is actually makruh. You know, this is makruh because the hadith of Abu Huraira, radiyallahu anhu, that he said, نَهَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ عَنِ الْإِخْتِصَارِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ. You know, and Abu Dawood reported it, يعني يضع يده على خاصرته. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم commanded us not to put our hands in on the khasr, on the side of the stomach. And Abu Dawood explained, it's reported by Abu Dawood, and he explained that it is what it is to put your hands on the side. In the madhab of Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he says that وَلَا يَضَعُ يَدَيْهِ عَلَى خَاصِرَتِهِ. You do not put your hands there. So why? لما نهي لما روى عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه نهى عن التخصر في الصلاة. You have the same thing, the Maliki madhab, it is counted as مكروهات الصلاة, as القاضي عياض mentioned. You know, in الحنبلي madhab, the same thing. It's agreed upon. There is no dispute over this. And I find it interesting, because why would anybody do this? Everybody knows it's put, the disagreement where you put the hands is never on the side. Some people think that it should be close to the heart. You know, and that's also baseless. The reports about the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam range from putting it on the you know, on the stomach, or putting it on the chest. And the even though the madahib, they said that it should be on the stomach, not higher than, you know, the top of the stomach. But really, there are hadiths that the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam washaddahuma ila sadri, and the sadr is above the button, it's above the belly. But and again, it's in the front, it's never on the heart, it's never on the waist. So I don't know why some people do that. Another makruh in the salah, another disliked action in the salah, is raf'ul basari ila as-sama', you know, to look to the sky while you're praying. Abu Huraira reported that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, لَيَنْتَهِيَنَّ أَقْوَامٌ يَرْفَعُونَ أَبْصَارَهُمْ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ أَوْ لَتُخْطَفَنَّ أَبْصَارُهُمْ. رواه أحمد ومسلم والنسائي. So that Abu Huraira reported that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, you know, people should stop looking up to the sky, you know, while in salah, or their vision or their eyesight might be taken away from them. And Imam al-Bukhari also reported it with the hadith that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَا بَالُ أَقْوَامٍ يَرْفَعُونَ أَبْصَارَهُمْ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ. Why are people looking up to the sky, you know, in their salah? And he فاشتد قوله في ذلك, so he emphasized it, حتى قال, until he, to the point where he says, لينتهن عن ذلك أو لتخطفن أبصارهم. That if they don't do that, their eyesight might be taken away. Now, some people, so it is makruh to look up in the sky, especially, you know, people, sometimes you see them after the coming up from ruku', you know. The sunnah and the khushu', the humility in a salah, that when we pray, you look where you mawdi' sujood, the place where you make sujood. You don't look up, even though we talked about when it's allowed, that if there is a need, you may look up or you look away from the, you know, as we mentioned in the last session. But if there is no need, the Muslim, the we're supposed to look at the place that we make the sujood. And the so when people come in the ruku' and when they do the ruku', they look up like that. This is something, again, that is from the makruhat of as-salah. The sunnah is to continue looking down. To the point, actually, where Ibn Hazm went, again, he's a dhahiri, he's a literalist, he said to the point that it nullifies the salah, as Ibn Hajar reported from him. Okay, so this is another thing that is not allowed in the salah. Now, is it allowed to outside of the salah when you make the dua to look up? There is no dalil that you're not allowed to. You know, there's no dalil, you know, that you cannot, when you make the dua, you say, Ya Allah. The salah has its own rules, and outside you may look up to the sky if you at the sky if you want to do that. You know, يعني that what Imam Ibn Hajar in Fath al-Bari, he said, قال ابن بطال أجمع على كراهة رفع البصر في الصلاة. There is a consensus amongst the ulama that is disliked to look up, you know, in the salah. واختلفوا فيه في يعني في رفع البصر خارج الصلاة في الدعاء. So there's disagreement amongst the ulama, you know, whether you may make dua when you make dua outside the salah, if you may look up or not. فكرهه شريح وطائفة. So شريح وطائفة. So some group disliked it وأجازه الأكثرون. But the majority of the ulama allowed it. Again, I don't know of any dalil that commands us not to look up, you know, when we make the dua outside of salah. Another item is an-nadharu ila ma yulhi, whatever distracts you, anything that distracts you, you are not to look at it. Aisha radiyallahu anha reported that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam salla fi khamisa laha a'lam. Faqala shaghalatni a'lamu hadihi idhhabu biha ila Abi Jahm wa'tuni bi'anbijaniyatihi. رواه مسلم والبخاري. البخاري report also from Anas قال كان قرام لعائشة سترت به جانب بيتها فقال لها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أميطي قرامك فإنه لا تزال تصاويره تعرض لي في صلاتي. So there are two hadiths in this section which is related to looking at anything that distracts you in the salah. The first is the hadith of عائشة رضي الله عنها that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى في خميصة لها أعلام. الخميصة, the hadith says that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم prayed wearing a خميصة. What is a خميصة? A خميصة is a dress or a garment that has خطوط, you know, lines, لها أعلام. It's normally made from wool, صوف, okay, but لها أعلام. And this was actually a gift from Abi Jahm, from Abu Jahm, you know, Abu Jahm, the one, you know, in another hadith when Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, when he proposed to the cousin of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he said, Amma Muawiyah fa huwa su'lukun, la mala lah, Muawiyah is poor, don't marry him. Wa amma Abu Jahm fa innahu la yada'u asahu an atiqih. You know, he's always carrying in, but still that, you know, don't marry Abu Jahm and don't marry Muawiyah. Muawiyah is poor and don't marry Abu Jahm because he hits, you know. Yet still he was close to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and he gave him a gift. And the gift was al-khamisa. Al-khamisa actually is not just wool, it is thin wool. From al-khams, you know, when the stomach is close to the back, you know, you have thin stomach. They refer to it as al-khams, you know, and or akhmas. And it when you fold it, it's thin, it's good quality. Okay, so Abu Jahm preferred put the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ahead of himself and gave him al-khamisa, the better one, and kept for him what they call al-anbijaniyya. Al-anbijaniyya is a thick material, you know, and it has no a'lam, it has no lines. Okay, so he gave the Rasul ﷺ the better one. When the Rasul ﷺ started praying with it, he saw it in the salah, it distracted him, you know, so he finished the salah, and after that he said, you know, idhabu biha ila Abi Jahm, to go take it back to Abu Jahm and give me the al-anbijaniyya, give me the other one. You know, so he swapped it. And that's reported by, again, Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Now, this is one hadith. I'll come to it, inshallah ta'ala, for more explanation in a second. The other hadith is also from Aisha radiallahu anha that reported by Bukhari that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Aisha had a qiram. Qiram is like a sitar, you know, like a curtain, you know, where it had drawings in it, tasawir, you know, and some in another report it was actually, you know, the tasawir of the or the pictures or the images of what the images of al-Buraq, you know. So and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed, so he said, take down your qiram, take down your curtain. And she put it on one side of the house. Why? Because it kept on coming back to me in my salah. It distracted him. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked her to remove it. And of course, there are other hadiths where, what did she do with it? She made it into pillows, you know, so they became on the floor. They're not no longer hanging. People would step on it, you know, on them and lay on them. So there's different things that we get from these hadiths. The first hadith, of course, is that, you know, in one report, what Imam Nawawi says in Sahih Muslim, in Sharh Sahih Muslim, he says in one report, she said, شغلتني أعلام هذه, you know, and another, ألهتني, in another report, another lafd, another riwayah, and in another riwayah for Bukhari, فأخاف أن تفتني, I'm afraid that it will distract me, you know. All of this is the same thing, which is that Rasul ﷺ wanted to focus in the salah, and these images and these things were distracting to him, alayhi salatu wasalam, so he got rid of them, you know. So now, from it also, what do we get? We get, as Nawawi says, it is also disliked to make ornate, you know, the mihrab. If you notice in the masajid nowadays, you will find the mosaic and the stones and the ayat of the Quran in the calligraphy, Arabic calligraphy, and I mean all of this. And actually, it's makruh, you know, and it is very distracting. If somebody is praying, it is distracting. The same thing with the rugs. Well, it's the same concept all around. Making the masjid ornate. If you like, if you go into a church and you see the glasses. The glass they have, the drawings in them, the paintings all over the place, the shiny things all over the place. These are things that distract you from ibadah. And the same thing now if you go to the, especially the well-to-do masajid, really the people who are well-to-do, you know, the millions of dollars, and you will find all kinds of calligraphy and the, like in one masjid, I was there a few days back, and they have Asma Allah al-Husna, the 99 names of Allah Ta'ala all around the masjid. It looks very nice, but it's also very distracting. You look in the mihrab and you will find, you know, this calligraphy with the very fine art. And all of this, again, it is makruh, you know. And that's what the Imam al-Nawawi, he says, وَكَرَهِيَةُ تَزْوِيقِ مِحْرَابِ الْمَسْجِدِ وَحَائِطِهِ وَنَقْشِهِ. The whole concept is not accepted. وَغَيْرِ ذَلِكَ مِنَ الشَّاغِلَاتِ. Anything that distracts you, you know. لِأَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Why do we get this? Because the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم جعل العلة في إزالة الخميصة هذا المعنى. The علة, the reason why Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم says, okay, take this خميصة, the nice clothes, the soft clothes, send them back, give me the other one. Why? It's because of the distraction. So the same rule applies. Al-illah, you know, the causality is the fact that it's distracting, and therefore it becomes makruh in every in everything that carries the same meaning. Okay, and he Nawawi rahimahullah, he says, وَهَذَا بِإِجْمَاعِ الْفُقَهَاء. There is consensus amongst the ulama, the fuqaha, on this. You know, Qurtubi rahimahullah, he said, اختَلَفَ النَّاسُ فِي الْخُشُوعِ. Because again, all of this, the distraction removes the khushu'. So he's saying, is this going to invalidate your salah? هل هذا من فرائض الصلاة? So if you're distracted, will it break your salah? He said, or this is من فضائلها ومكملاتها, or these are the things to perfect the salah. So he said, رحمه الله على قولين والصحيح الأول, that it is what? It is the... he considers the khushu' from fara'id al-salah. Okay. Now, the other meaning here is that, by the way, is the other the hadith that's reported by Imam al-Bukhari about having the items with pictures on them, etc. If the place that you hang these things, the paintings, the things of this sort, is a place that's prepared for al-ibadah, it is not allowed. You know, it is haram. It's not a matter of makruhat. It is and anything that would honor it, that would show it that it has, you know, high status, especially in the place of where ibadah. Like Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he ordered all the idols, all the drawings, anything that was related to shirk around the Kaaba, after the Fath Makkah, after the conquest of Makkah, to be removed. You know, in places of ibadah, you are not allowed, we're not allowed to keep such things. But if it is not in a place of ibadah, like the dolls for the children, the girls, the toys, if they are muhan, and if something that is thrown around, just like Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam ordered Aisha, you know, remove the curtain from a place that was prepared for ibadah to a pillow and wisadatin and you know, the something on the floor, that's muhan. This is not respected, so it is okay. But if it is in a place that's prepared for worship, we're not allowed to keep it. Okay. Another disliked, another something that is not allowed to do is تغميض العينين, closing your eyes. Now, تغميض العينين, you know, and here's the interesting thing. Look at if you read Sayyid Sabiq's paragraph about تغميض العينين, there is no hadith. Because there is none. There is no evidence, there is no dalil that says you should not. The only what we have is that Rasulullah did not close his eyes when he prayed. Mm-hmm. You know, but there is no nahi, there is no verbal command from Rasulullah that says do not close your eyes. Right. You know, mm-hmm. So yet the ulama, all the ulama have the agreement that it is makruh.
He never did it. It was
yeah, but the fact that he did not, I'll give you why they said that it is not makruh. اتفق العلماء على كراهة تغميض العينين. So there is a disagreement that it is makruh, disliked. Again, disliked معناها it does not break the salah, but what it does, it's you just losing ajr, if you wish, or you're not getting ajr, more ajr for keeping them open. لغير الحاجة. So there's a disagreement. There's no disagreement about this. So in the book of the Hanbali madhab, for example, they say that it is from فعل يهود. So now the Jews, when they pray, you know, they close their eyes. Okay, and therefore it becomes from مخالفت المشركين ومخالفت, you know, that's one reason why they did it. You know, but other scholars said that actually if there is a need, if there is no need, there is everybody saying it's okay. If there is a need, well, what kind of need? Why would you want to close your eyes? They said maybe for khushu', for concentration. Maybe you get distracted if you keep them open. Maybe you know, there is some maslaha. Maybe you are watching a baby. I'm sorry, closing eyes. as the opposite. Yeah. But it is so. They would said if there is a need, you may close your eyes. Okay. So for example, Imam Al-Izz bin Abd al-Salam, and actually Ibn Qayyim agreed with him. Al-Izz bin Abd al-Salam said in his fatwa that it is allowed if there is a need, if that makes the person who's making the salah have more khushu'. If you have more khushu' in closing your eyes, it is perfectly okay. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said in Zad al-Ma'ad that if the person gets more khushu' by keeping your eyes open, then keep them open. And if there is more khushu' for you to keep them closed because it will get distracted because of maybe التزويق في المسجد, you know, the ornate carpet or محراب or the calligraphy or whatever, or people walking around, you know, then فلا ف, so what did he say? He says فإنه لا يكره قطعا, definitely it's not مكروه, بل القول باستحباب التغميض أقرب إلى مقاصد الشريعة وأصوله من القول بالكراهة. But because the خشوع is what you want to get in the salah, so he's saying actually it is better for you to close your eyes. But again, without, there is no haja, there is no reason for you to close your eyes. You know, the asl, if you wish, is to pray with your eyes open. If there is a haja, and when I say there is a need for it, even if the need is more khushu', you know, it is okay to do it. Okay?
How come nobody tried to correlate between this and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Isn't that supposed to be from Hayat Salah?
Well, no, yani, I...
You didn't mention any correlation between...
Correct. And the... if... and if I were to speak off the top of my head, I would say that the salah, the movement of the salah, the غير عن, different from الأعمال الجبلية, يعني the closing the eyes, opening the eyes, etc. They took it as from الأعمال الجبلية, the natural actions of الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم as a human being. But all of them focused on the أعمال, the actions of salah itself. I don't think they took the whether he kept his eyes open or closed, even though we don't have reports that he closed his eyes otherwise. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the most watched human being on the surface of earth, you know, by his sahaba. Literally, they even counted how many teeth he showed when he smiled. You know, how did he walk? How did, you know, he, how did he turn around? Did he turn partially or the whole thing? You know, they would tell you he was sitting and then he sat up. When he sat up, he sat up like this. He's very, very much watched in his private life and in his public life. And even with the mothers of the believers, Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, you know, they used to, Aisha radiallahu anha, Umm Salama, his wives used to report every little thing about him, alayhi salatu wasalam. Even when the way he showered, you know, he took a bath, you know, leave some for me, leave some for me. She, even that private things, radiallahu anha, reported it, right? Because that's the deen. So I'm saying, if it was understood that it was part of the salah, that it would have been reported. But I've never seen.
He even forbid where to look and command where to look. So the where to look is actually a part of the salah, because he forbid you to look up and ordain you to look where you sujood.
If I am,
so it's a part of the height of the salah. Otherwise, he wouldn't actually put too much effort in it.
Yeah,
that's how I view it in my humble view.
No, Allah Barak Fik. I don't remember off the top of my head if the if Sheikh Jalal, if you remember, is there a dalil or a hadith that says you look where you make your sujood?
As a hadith, I don't remember out of my head.
Yeah, no, because I don't remember either. Actually, all I know is that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam he used to look up. And then Allah Ta'ala commanded him فَطَأْطَأَ رَأْسَهُ. And I don't remember the beginning of the hadith, but فَطَأْطَأَ رَأْسَهُ, you know, so he lowered it. But the statements of the ulama where to look as really just from the kamal of the salah, just to show humility, you know. But I don't remember, and inshallah I can look it up and come back next week بِإِذْنِهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. If there's such a thing, but no. Okay, another thing, something that is also disliked is al-ishara bil-yadayni عند السلام. When you are in the salah and you're about to make the salam, you know, and you have some people, and I still see them till today, and yeah, I have no idea where they got this from. Is that when they make the salah, they would either do this with their hand, sometimes they just flip it this way and that way, you know? Literally, assalamu alaikum, and they would find them turning their hand and turning their hand. جابر reported جابر بن سمرة reported قال كنا نصلي خلف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال ما بال هؤلاء يسلمون بأيديهم كأنهم أذناب خيل شمس إنما يكفي أحدكم أن يضع يده على فخذه ثم يقول السلام عليكم السلام عليكم رواه النسائي وغيره. So Jabir ibn Samra reported that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that he, Jabir ibn Samra said that we were praying behind behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he said, why are these people, you know, making the salam with their hands, you know, as if they are adnabu khaylin shums. Al-khayl al-shums, the rebellion horses, you know, because they would throw their hands in when they make the salam, they would throw their hands. So he's saying, why are they like these wild, you know, the tails of wild animals, you know, flipping their hands? All they need to do is just to put their hands on their thighs, you know, and then say assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum, you know. And here, by the way, if you notice, I mean, we don't say, even though you may say assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum, but normally we say assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah or assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, etc. But this is the minimum. He mentioned alayhi salatu wa salam, the bare minimum, innama yakfi, al-kifaya, and what is enough for them. So really, when we do the salam, and this is different from when somebody says assalamu alaikum while you're praying. Remember when we said that while you're praying, if somebody says assalamu alaikum, you may actually raise your hand or your finger or something to shir ilay, you know, that you answered the salam. And we discussed this in the last session. But when you are praying and you are making a salam, you know, ending the salah, in other words, you don't move your hands. Your hands are supposed to remain on your thighs. Okay, if you do it, if you move them, again, your salah is still valid. There is, you're not breaking the salah, but you did something that is makruh. And if for somebody who's standing up to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why would you want to do something that is makruh? Another thing that is disliked is taqtiyatul fammi wassadl, you know, covering the mouth. And sadl or as-sabl. Here the hadith talks about the sadl, but it's the same meaning as sabl, and we'll talk about it inshallah ta'ala. And the hadith is from Abu Huraira that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam naha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-sadli fi salah wa an yughatti ar-rajulu fah. Rawahu al-khamsa wal-hakim. So that this hadith from Abu Huraira that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us not to do sadl fi salah, and I will talk about what the sadl is in a minute, and to cover one's mouth. And the hadith is reported by the five, so the five reporters, with the exception of course of now means Bukhari and Muslim are excluded, but also al-Hakim reported it. Now, and he said sahih ala shart Muslim. Here actually Sheikh Sayyid Sadiq rahimahullah, yani he did not give the full story. And it's in the book, is introduction book. The hadith was reported, you know, the sentence when you got for the person to cover his mouth. This something Abu Isa with Tirmidhi said that after he reported from Ata, he said there is no such statement that the person would cover his mouth. There is no such statement. Al-Shawkani Nail Awtar, he said, Al-Tirmidhi said, we only know this hadith from Ata' from Abu Huraira Barfu', meaning to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, from one person, Isl bin Sufyan. You know, Isl bin Sufyan is the only person who reported from Abu Huraira, you know, from through Abu Huraira to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And Al-Hakim mentioned it in Mustadrak from the same way that Abu Dawood reported it. Okay, and he said that this is following a Shaykhin method. But they did not have this addition, and the person is to hide his or to cover his mouth in his salah. So Shawkani rahimahullah in Nail Awtar, he said the ulama al-a'imma had a difference of opinion about using the hadith that we just cited from Abu Huraira, that, you know, نهى عن السدل وأن يغطي الرجل فاه. So some of them did not use the hadith totally. Why? Because عسل بن سفيان is the only reporter. تفرد به. Okay. And Imam Ahmad said that he is ضعيف. عسل بن سفيان is a weak person. الخلال said, سئل أحمد عن حديث السدل في الصلاة من حديث أبو هريرة فقال ليس هو بصحيح الإسناد. إمام أحمد ضعفه. Called it, it's a حديث ضعيف. وقال, meaning إمام أحمد said, عسل بن سفيان غير محكم الحديث. His hadith is not sound. ضعفه الجمهور, يحيى بن معين وأبو حاتم والبخاري وآخرون. So in other words, now the reporter, the sole reporter of this hadith, you know, is ضعيف. But, and here's where you will see difference of opinion amongst the ulama. Ibn Hibban, you know, mentioned him amongst the thiqat. He said he is thiqah. And just this is just to show that really the judgment on the scholar, on the reporters of hadith is subjective. It is subjective. It is not absolute. You know, يعني you have muhaddithin or reporters of al-Bukhari that you have other ulama criticized, of Muslim ulama criticized. Don't misunderstand me. It does not mean that the hadiths in Bukhari or Muslim are weak. I'm saying the reporters, a specific reporter was criticized. They used reporters that other scholars considered to be a report. The ilm al-hadith and the al-rijal, al-jarh wal-ta'dil, there are many aspects of it that are subjective based on the on this on the judgment of the muhaddith. Now look, for example, Abu Dawood reported it. Abu Dawood reported, but look at also why he's rejecting it. Abu Dawood reported it and he rejects it. Why did Abu Dawood rejected it? He said rawahu isnadihi ila ibn Jurayj. Then he said aktharu ma ra'ayt, أكثر ما رأيت عطاء أن يصلي سادلا. السدل, by the way, one meaning of السدل is to is الإسبال, to make it, to make your clothes as الشيخ سيد سابق mentioned, إرسال الثوب حتى يصيب الأرض. You know, السدل in the old days they used to wear the clothes to fancy, to show that they're fancy and they're, you know, like how the ropes of the kings and that's how they out of arrogance, خيلاء. So Allah Ta'ala forbade this. Not just dragging the clothes, anything that you wear خيلاء, to stand out, to show that you are better than people, you know, this is forbidden. Even if, because the illa, the causality exists in anything that makes it خيلاء, even in a shirt, you know. So the point here is that Ibn Sayyid Sabiq uses the word of a definition of al-Khattabi that sadl is the isbal, is for it to reach the ground. But also sadl means that when you wear the you know, like a jibba or the abay, but you don't put your hands in it. You know how they just put it on the shoulders and your hands are there and you pray? That is makruh. That is makruh.
Based on the hadith?
No, based on this hadith. Because of the word sadl. Well, because here's the thing. Even Abu Dawood says, you know, رأيت عطاء أن يصلي سادلا. طب عطاء is the reporter of the hadith. How could the reporter of the hadith, who's telling you makruh, how could he do it? Now somebody says, well, it is makruh, but he did it. But that was not the characteristic of the Sahaba. The Sahaba, رضي الله عنهم, they were not, as I said, they even though they were afqah in nas, by definition, they are the first generation. You know, they are the most, the people who understood the deen the most. But they did not differentiate, or they did not ask when they heard something, a command from Rasul, is this fard or sunnah? It's enough. What do you want as a Muslim who wants to get closer to Allah Ta'ala? You know, what do you care, fard or sunnah? Rasul did it, that's it. You know, and but you find that when they saw Ata, praying sadil, and Abu Dawood said, وَهَذَا يُضَعْفْ ذَلِكَ الْحَدِيثِ. And this manhaj, by the way, also exists with Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa, he tells you, okay, I reject this hadith. Why do you reject this hadith? Well, if the reporter practiced the opposite of what he reports. Because if the hadith is sahih, that meaning the reporter actually said it, you know, he's not going to act differently from what
is
he reported.
Is that why the Hanabila fold their pants?
Actually, not the Hanafis.
The Hanafis.
Yeah. I mean, there are many hadiths, by the way, about the clothes of the Sahaba wear, you know, to their calves, etc. But again, really, many people who do it now, it's
But isn't every نهى عن كف الثوب وتني وتشميره لأنك كيف ما ينفعش تشمك
هو to start with the command what you see now what people do now they do it in the salah or for the salah
yeah.
And actually the clothing, whether how long and how short, has nothing to do with the salah specifically. It has to do with the way you dress, generally. It's not that the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was used to wear, and the Sahaba used to wear long clothes, but when it came to salah, they pulled them up, you know. Here,
because was that arrogant?
Yeah, and that's exactly it. So the question is, when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq heard the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, "Man jarra thawbahu khuyala," you know. So Abu Bakr, whoever drags his clothes out of arrogance. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, you know, he used to be a skinny person, and his izar was always falling. So he said, you know, "Hatta ana." Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, "No, laysa ant. You're not. Yeah, exactly. Lasta minhum. You're not from them." Why Abu Bakr has a different Sharia from the rest of the people? But Abu Bakr did not drag his clothes out of arrogance.
Right.
That was not the intention here. And I'm saying, yani, look, every era has its way of dress. And what dictates what arrogance means. What could be arrogant yesterday is not necessarily today. This is norms amongst the people. The illa here, it transcends time and place. Anything that you wear, as I said, now you can go and wear a shirt for $1,000. You can go buy a shirt for $100. For $1,000, and you can buy a shirt for $20. You're and it's not that the price. There's certain clothes, certain styles, certain things that are known to be. This is the show off. This is the arrogance. This is the they dictate that. And there are certain clothes, they can be expensive, but they're not like that. Every people have what dictates arrogance. You know, that is based on the urf amongst the people. What is acceptable amongst the people as arrogant versus not arrogant. And I'm saying that the people who stuck to wearing, you know, the clothes up to here, honestly, they're living to in an era that is not... the illa there does not apply... What applied there does not apply here today, you know?
Isdal is not a point of arrogance now.
Now it's not. But and you have people who are wearing these clothes, you know? So anyway, I mean, that's the point. But you're for the salah itself, if you are going to wear it completely, it has nothing to do really with the salah. It's supposed to be worn all the time, you know? Anyway, so this is the one thing, and the same thing, by the way, Dar Qutni mentioned in his book Al-Ilal about this hadith. When he was asked, he said, after he mentioned the difference, because there's a difference of opinion between Rafi' and Waqf, you know, is this really the statement of Abu Hurairah? Remember, I said there's only one report for Rafi', you know, from Isl. So when Dar Qutni was, after mentioning the difference of opinion, and there's only one report or one chain to for Rafi', he said, "Wa fi Rafi'ihi nadar." الدار قطني. Why؟ لأن ابن جريج روى عن عطاء بن أبي رباح أنه كان يستل في الصلاة. يعني عطاء بن رباح himself used to wear his clothes in this way in الصلاة. أوكي. الحاكم when he said that هذا صحيح على شرط الشيخين. This حديث صحيح following the terms or the requirements, excuse me, of Bukhari and Muslim. You know what did he said? He said ولم يخرج في ولم يخرج في تغذية الرجل فاهو في الصلاة. They did not report covering the mouth in the صلاة. This is something that Sayyid Sabiq رحمه الله does not mention. And that part, the first part, the sadl is disputed between الرفع. Is it statement to الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم or the صحابي? And then you have the scholars of hadith reject it because of that. The other part of it, الحاكم did not said that this was on the conditions of the Bukhari and Muslim, that part. Okay, so Abu Ubaidah, he said the sadl isbal al-rajul thawbahu min ghayri an yadum janibayhi bayna dayhi fayandammahu falaysa bisadl. Isbal al-rajul, you know, means when you wear it, you don't keep it tight to you. And this is just the last couple of items, inshallah ta'ala, and we're done. As-salatu bihadrat al-ta'am, praying while the food is present. This is dislike to pray. Some people think that it is taqwa to go pray before the food. And actually the taqwa is to get closer to Allah ta'ala with what Allah ta'ala likes, as he commanded. So you start with the food and then you pray. And this is
even if you're gonna miss the salah.
But I'm coming to that. يعني عائشة, look at the text of the hadith, look at the verbiage of the hadith, الألفاظ. عن عائشة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا وضع العشاء وأقيمت الصلاة فابدأوا بالعشاء. رواه أحمد مسلم. So look at the wording. If the salah, if the dinner is prepared, and of course it's not related to dinner because there's another hadith, la salata bihadrati ta'am. So it's not just dinner, it's any meal. Okay. If the dinner is prepared and the salah is called, uqimat, the iqama of salah is called, ma'anah it's at the beginning of the time, not the end of the time. Okay, because normally people pray at the beginning of the time. فابدأوا بالعشاء, then you start with العشاء. That's one. نافع reported from Ibn Umar, كان يوضع له الطعام وتقام الصلاة فلا يأتيها حتى يفرغ وإن يسمع قراءة الإمام. So نافع reported that Ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما, he would have the food sitting, you know, and the salah would be called, and he would not go to salah even though he's reading and listening to the Imam reciting. So what is he missing? Salat al-Jama'ah. He's missing Salat al-Jama'ah.
Not
missing the time. He's missing awwal al-waqt. You know? So what is the point here? The point is that and this is really from the rahmah of Allah Ta'ala, you know, and the kamal al-khushu', the perfection of the concentration on the salah. Even this, yani when the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, not only in this, when he would interrupt his salah to go and pick up a child who's crying in the masjid. Well, he's taking it easy on the woman after him until the day of judgment, who hears her baby cry, you know, who hears the baby cry and saying, you know, because the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in salah picked up, Hassan Hussein picked up Zainab. So that action, that mercy is shown to at his time is a rahmat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until the day of judgment. Every woman who hears her baby cry or she wants to carry the baby, you know, she's able to do that in the salah, you know. So my point here is that the same thing, to go to eat so that you can perfect your salah, focus on your salah. Now here, by the way, it is not... you know, some people say, well, is it at the, how about if you miss the salah? If you miss the salah, no, the fard comes. Because this is the sunnah, the preferred, يعني إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابة موقوتة. This is the فرض. صلاة الست at a certain time, that's the established fact. You have the حديث of الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, you know, the لا صلاة بحضر الطعام, or you know, this is all on the mandubat, the preference. So because if a Muslim leaves the dinner and goes to pray, is his salah for, is he, has he done something haram? He has not done something haram. He just neglected or he did not fulfill the sunnah. But the point here is that it shows that it is better than salat al-jama'ah that you finish your food first until you're done. Not even like, oh, let me grab a bite and run to the salah. No, finish your food and go. This is from the rahmah of Allah Ta'ala. And the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَن تُؤْتَى رُخَصُهُ كَمَا تُؤْتَى عَزَائِمُهُ. Allah likes the permissibilities to be taken just like the obligations. You know, so the point here is that even if the salah is, and as Ibn Baz says, you know, وَهَذَا لَيْسَ مِنْ التَّهْوِينِ مِنْ شَأْنِهَا بَلْ هَذَا مِنْ تَعْظِيمِ شَأْنِهَا. This is how you give honor to salah. Why? لأنه إذا أتاها وقلبه مشغول لم يخشع فيها كما ينبغي. Somebody is hungry, thinking of his stomach. Somebody is worried about their children, thinking of the child. You know, carry the child. Carry the child and pray. You know, these are the things from the rukhas from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. Another one that's also disliked. الصلاة مع مدافعة الأخبثين ونحوهما مما يشغل القلب. You know, the hadith of الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, ثلاث لا تحل لأحد أن يفعلهن. The three things that are not allowed for anybody to do. One, لا يأم رجل قوما فيخص نفسه بالدعاء. Nobody is to lead other people and make dua for himself, not them. Okay, يعني when you're leading the people and you say اللهم ارحمني, طب والباقي, you know, what about the other ones, you know, no, اللهم ارحمنا, you know. So the dua is for everybody. فإن فعل فقد خانهم, he betrayed them. ولا ينظر في قعر بيت قبل أن يستأذن, and nobody looks in the house before you seek permission. فإن فعل فقد دخل, you know, if he does it as if he entered without permission, why do you knock? You know, why do you, and this is, by the way, look at some left things that are still remaining from Islam, even though we do them as traditionally. When people come and knock at the door, what do they do? They knock and they step aside from the door. They don't stay facing the door. Here, people might say, where are you going? You're going so that when the door is open, even by the man, you don't know who's going to be inside, what you're going to see inside.
Let the people now.
And this is and this is the respect that Islam teaches us to the privacy of the house, that you don't do this, you know, you don't look inside the house and wait and no, you knock and you get away from the doorway so that you don't see. These are from adab, akhlaq al-Islam. You know, this is what Islam teaches us. And it still exists, maybe as a tradition, but actually it has a basis, which is what, you know, the hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَا يَنْظُرُ فِي قُعْرِ بَيْتٍ حَتَّى يَسْتَأْذِنْ. You know, and that's why you find them, يا ساتر, why are you doing this? You know, because the houses are awrat, you know, and this is from the what Islam teaches us. وَلَا يُصَلِّ وَهُوَ حَاقِنٌ حَتَّى يَتَخَفَّفْ. And nobody should pray while haqin is the one who's holding his urine, you know, and وهو حتى يتخفف, until you go and relieve yourself. I guarantee you, all of us have done it. You'd be praying and you'd be dancing. You're not praying. You're dancing because you cannot stand up straight to finish your salah. Even if you can, you're just want to finish it because you need to go to the bathroom. And Allah Ta'ala غني عن صلاتنا بهذا الشكل. You know, Allah Ta'ala doesn't need our salah like that. Isn't it the point to get closer to Allah Ta'ala? Go to the bathroom, relieve yourself, make your wudu, come back and you pray. Water is cold. Continue the dance sequence. Another hadith for report by Imam Ahmad and Muslim and others from Aisha قالت سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لا يصلي أحد بحضرة طعام ولا هو يدافعه الأخبثان. That nobody should pray while the food is sitting, and nor should he pray while he is fighting الأخبثان, meaning he wants to use the bathroom, number one or number two, you know. And by the way, but technically, if a person does do that and does pray, you know, the salah is valid. Again, this is makruhat al-salah, not mubtilat al-salah, you know. And the last one before the last, as-salatu 'inda mughalabati an-nawm. 'Inda mughalabati an-nawm. Aisha reported that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إذا نعس أحدكم فليرقد حتى يذهب عنه النوم فإنه إذا صلى وهو ناعس لعله يذهب يستغفر فيسب نفسه. رواه الجماعة. You know, do not pray. عائشة reported that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم says, if you are sleepy, then sleep until you get out, until you sleep is gone. You know, because if you are praying and you're sleepy, you know, you think you're making istighfar, but you might be cursing yourself. You have no idea what you're saying, basically. So here the word sleepy explains the state of being you are in, that you are very sleepy, that you're not able to know, to distinguish what you are saying.
But if you even, you know, a little bit, you can pray.
No, if you know, not a little bit or not a lot, you're aware of what you're saying, yeah, you're fine. You know, now, finally, the last item is having one place in the masjid for salah, you know, other aside from the imam. The only person who's allowed to pray in the same, not allowed, everybody's allowed to pray in the same place, who it's okay to pray in the same place is the imam, al-mihrab. Mm-hmm. But everybody else, you know, the idea of taking one spot in the masjid, this is my corner. This is my corner. Where does so-and-so sit? In that corner. You know, in this corner. You know, this is actually from makruhat. There is a hadith to make it makruh. يعني عبد الرحمن بن شبل قال نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن نقرة الغراب وافتراش السبع وأن يوطد الرجل المكان في المسجد كما يوطن البعير. رواه أحمد بن خزيمة. That, you know, it is Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us not to do naqrat al-ghurab, you know, this like a chicken when you pray, waftirash al-sab', and when you make your sujood, you put your elbows and your hands, you know, in the sujood, and to put yourself to always sit in one place in the masjid, just like al-ba'ir, just like the camel is put in one place all the time, you know. And as you, Akhi Ahmed, mentioned, I mean, the wherever you go pray, the earth makes the testimony for you that you prayed there. So always pray in different places in the masjid. There is no reserved spot, you know. This is always somebody's spot. That is makruh to do. Any questions so far?
والواحد إن شاء الله لما بيصلي الملائكة بتشوف صلاته، يعني هل أتم السجود، أتم الركوع، لكن الله سبحانه وتعالى هو بيطلع على القلب في الخشوع، فهم بيكتبوا هل الصلاة تامة ولا منقوصة، لكن الخشوع في الصلاة يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى بيحدده. فهل ربنا سبحانه وتعالى بيجزع عليه بقى، ربنا هو اللي بيحطه في الكتاب ولا بيأمر الملائكة بكتابته في الكتاب؟
I don't know. I know that the ones who record the actions, الملائكه تكتب الاعمال. But ربنا سبحانه يعني هذا التقسيم, this classification, I don't know. I know that Allah سبحانه وتعالى يعلم السر واخفى. He knows every person how he prays, what he comprehends, ما يعقل من صلاته وما لا يعقل, what he comprehends from الصلاة, what he does not. Allah سبحانه وتعالى is the one who knows. But يعني هو أي يعني الله أعلم. I don't know.
علم ما علم الله.
No, the let's not go into
beyond.
Yeah, all we know is that, you know, إذ يتلقى المتلقيان عن اليمين وعن الشمال قعيد ما يلفظ من قول إلا لديه رقيب عتيد. You know, and you have the Malaika, as we know from the Hadiths and etc. But we, and that's where I stop. طيب إن شاء الله تعالى نقف هنا. We will stop here and next time بإذنه عز وجل we will talk about مبطلات الصلاة. What breaks the salah or what invalidates the salah. And if we, I don't know if we'll have time after that to do talk about qada as-salah, you know, making up the salah, but inshallah ta'ala we'll do the mubtilat at least. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim wal asr. Innal insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilus salihati wa tawassaw bil haqqi wa tawassaw bis sabr wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakumullahu khairan.